From the WLOE and WMYN News and Public Affairs Department, this is Community Accents, connecting Rockingham County people, businesses, and services, recorded live on location and broadcast Monday through Friday at 8:30 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. Video production funding provided by the Rockingham County Business and Technology Center. Entrepreneur focused, technology enabled, future driven.
Good morning. You're tuned into Community Accents this brisk Friday morning, November the 15th. You're in with the Sheriff's Office today. I'm your Public Information Officer, Kevin Suthard, with the Sheriff's Office. And to my right is Administrative Captain Billy King this morning. Captain, good morning to you.
Good morning.
Good to have you here. The Sheriff couldn't make it today, but we're fortunate that you were able to come and be on the show with us. How about tell our listening audience a little bit about yourself? I know that you've got a lot of years in law enforcement, a lot of experience comes to the interview this morning with you. I know you've done a lot of different things in law enforcement, had a lengthy career. Tell our listeners a little bit about that.
Well, I'm Billy King. I'm the administrative captain with the Sheriff's Office. I've been there 25 years, almost 26 years. I've done a little bit of everything. I've worked in the jail, dispatch when we used to dispatch calls, and I've been a patrol officer, and worked it my way up, did a little bit of investigation work and everything. So I've done a little bit of everything in the Sheriff's Department in my tenure there. It's been a very exciting and fun career.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And you were my first supervisor when I came on to the Sheriff's Office on patrol. I like to tell everybody there, all the things that are wrong with me is Captain King's fault. So yeah, you trained me that way.
I guess I have to take the credit for that.
All right. Now, currently you're the administrative captain there at the Sheriff's Office. You supervise several different divisions, including myself, but also the Records Division and the Civil Division at the Sheriff's Office. Why don't you tell our listeners a little bit about why those divisions are important? What sets them apart from just a regular police department, sets us apart from a regular police department in those aspects because of the Civil Division and stuff like that?
Well, the Sheriff's Department is one of the only agencies across the state that is required by statute and law to serve civil process. That's actually, if you go back and look at the Constitution of the state of North Carolina, that is one of the duties spelled out that the sheriff will serve civil process.
Specifically to the sheriff.
Right. Mm-hmm. So he has to take care of all the civil process that comes in from the courts and make sure that it is timely served and properly served and returned back to the courts. Mm-hmm. We have several officers that's what they do is serve just the civil process that come into the agency. And because it is so important a function of the Sheriff's Department, like I say, we feel like we need specialized people who know, because there are different things that have to be done and in certain time lengths have to be done.
So a lot of rules and laws accompanied by the service of civil process.
That's correct.
And civil process specifically are things like when one individual will sue another individual, or maybe a landlord will evict a tenant, or they'll serve a judgment to collect a debt, stuff like that. That's what we're talking about when we say civil. It's generally not the criminal aspect of the law, but still the court side. Civil Division takes care of all of those specific duties. Also, you're over our Records Department there at the Sheriff's Office. They've got a lot of big duties, including issuing gun permits, concealed carry, and purchase permits there. Big responsibility there.
That's correct. The Records Division, by law, you're required to maintain public records. And here again, that goes back to statute. And you're also people who are wanting access to these records. They're entitled to certain information under the Freedom of Information laws, and we must make sure that we provide that for them. There are fees associated with this stuff because of the cost and that stuff in generating these copies of these files and information that they want. We also issue the gun permits, purchase permits. You have to have a purchase permit from the sheriff if you wish to purchase a handgun. Mm-hmm. Rifles and long guns, you can do that through your local dealer or whatever. Mm-hmm. But you do have to have a pistol purchase permit. They also issue the concealed carry weapons permit. So if you want to be able to carry a weapon concealed, handgun only again, they issue those and stuff. And there's fees that apply to all that. They also have the sex offender registry, which in the state of North Carolina, if you're convicted of certain crimes, you're required to register with the sheriff of that county on the state registration, sex offender registration, and we have to maintain that registry and file and report all this stuff to the state so that people can go on the internet and see if there's registered sex offenders, where they live and things like that, and what exactly they were charged with to be put on the registry.
Exactly, yeah.
Sex offender and all that's public information.
Yes, keeping up with that's a big task, too.
That is correct.
You also supervise the training officer, like I said, who makes sure that we have we are in compliance with all the safety OSHA safety regulations there at the sheriff's office, and making sure that all the members of the sheriff's office receive the standard training that we're supposed to receive, mandated training every year. You are also in charge of the public information officer, which is yours truly. Which is a thankless task, I know. It's no doubt takes up most of your time, but
yeah, the training, we are required by state statute again to do 24 hours of in-service training at a minimum, mm-hmm. and they come out each year with certain topics that they feel are things that they see are issues or law enforcement has requested, hey, we'd like more information in this area. Mm-hmm. So each year we have to do in-service training. You have to qualify with your firearm. You have legal updates, which is mandated each year, and right. those type things are so that law enforcement officers can stay abreast of what's changing in the law, how court decisions have changed the way you do things and stuff. So we have to do all that each year, and like I said, I do say 24 hours minimum because most officers get many more hours than that because, like
that
I say, it's an ongoing thing.
Well, things are always changing exactly. in our line of work, and we have to keep up with it. It's on us to keep up with all the changes in the laws and stuff as they're coming out.
Right, new techniques come out on stuff. And
new technology and stuff.
New technology too. And mm-hmm. things, so it's constant training.
Exactly. And also the training officer, like I said, Sergeant Kelly Lipford, is also in charge of safety there at the Sheriff's Office. And I think it's important to note and give a little shout-out to him for being responsible for the safety award that we got last year from OSHA. That award was the first time that a law enforcement agency across America has received that award for being in compliance and being above and beyond in the ways of safety there at our department. So, you know, hats off to him for helping make that happen.
Yep.
All right, we got a lot to get into, so let's jump right in. Veterans Day has come and gone once again. We had a lot of activities over this past weekend. Captain, tell us a few things, you know, that we were involved in. I know there was a lot.
Yeah, there were many, many activities. You know, everybody is supportive of the veterans, and we are very, very supportive of all our veterans. We thank everybody who has served or is serving this great country and the sacrifices that they have to make so that, you know, all the cities and county and everybody tries to show them their appreciation with different events and festivals and things like that. There was several parades, several community events. I think the Veterans Park there in Wentworth, mm-hmm. they have a big thing, and we're always a big supporter of that. And like I say, we do appreciate everything our veterans have done and will continue to do for the active and serving people.
All right, the Veterans Parade in Draper, that's always a yes. good time. The Bethany Elementary kids put on quite the show last Friday. It was very well received. yeah, the sheriff and I were there for that. The sheriff spoke, which it's important to know, too, the sheriff is a veteran,
yes.
Spent several years in the Air Force, yeah. And is very supportive of the veterans as well. But those kids, I'm going to tell you what, it was impressive to watch because it was like a military operation. The gym is not a big gym there at Bethany Elementary School, mm-hmm. and so they had to kind of, you know, wheel them in shifts, and it was just so organized. All the children come in it was like a military fashion right there, the way they had them all squared away. So that was very impressive as well. Again, we want to thank our veterans. Remember that freedom isn't free. A vet paid for your freedom. And if you know a vet or see a vet, it's important to thank them for what they do. I know most of the vets that I know, they're not they don't brag on what they do. They just see it as their duty. They've done what they needed to do. You know, my grandfather, father, both a vet, you know, they don't really talk about it. And, you know, my grandfather was in World War II. My father was in Vietnam, you know, and they don't really talk about it that much. And most mm-hmm. of them won't. But, you know, just thank them for what they've done because they've earned it. Okay. All right. Now that Veterans Day is behind us, we've got several more holidays coming up, creeping up on us fast. Turkey Day is coming up here in another week, is it? I think it's next week.
That's correct.
Then right around the corner, we're having the Christmas holidays coming up as well. A lot of things to talk about there. I know you wanted to address some things about Christmas. Now, Christmas is the Christmas holidays and all around in December. We generally do see an increase in crime in the communities here in Rockingham County and abroad, across America. I think we see crimes of theft and robbery and such increase, and other crimes as well. Kevin, why don't you tell us a few things about that?
Well, one thing I'd like to remind people is, like I say, we are coming up on what I call holiday season. You know, mm-hmm. Thanksgiving's coming. Christmas will be right around the corner. Time seems to fly so quick. It just seemed like we were just at 4th of July last week to me. But yeah. So time is moving quick. We do have to be cautious, though, because, like I say, there are people out there. You know, times are hard. People are out of work. They're trying to scrape by as best they can. And some people tend to take advantage of the situation, of things that they see. If you are going to be out shopping, we remind you that, you know, be mindful of your surroundings.
Exactly.
Ladies need to be mindful of their pocketbook. Keep it close. Don't make yourself a target. There's certain things you could do to help you with that. Be mindful of where you put your packages. You know, if you put them in the trunks, out of sight, out of mind type situation. Don't leave stuff laying, sitting in your car in a parking lot that somebody can just walk by and see. And because sometimes people, I hate to say it, it's a crime of opportunity.
You right.
know, they may not really be up to no good, but then again, when they go, well, wait a minute, this is just too easy.
Lock your door. Criminals are always looking for easy targets.
Exactly. Keep your car doors locked. Make sure before, if you're walking out to your car from a mall or shopping or whatever, have your keys already in your hand, so as soon as you get to your car, you can unlock your car and get in your car so that you don't spend a lot of time fumbling around trying to, you know, find your keys and stuff like that. Make sure that, like I say, you take these type precautions and stuff. The other thing I like to remind people is, you know, not just that kind of safety, we also need to be mindful that when we're on the road, there's a lot of people that are traveling.
Right.
A lot of more traffic on the road. You need to be more cautious and mindful of the fact that when you're out there traveling, everybody's tempers tend to get hot. They're trying to get where they want to go, and everybody's trying to get where they want to go. So we ask everybody, hey, take the time, slow down, get where you want to go safely. We don't want accidents. We don't want to see people injured or hurt. And you need to try to be courteous to other people, you know, if you're trying to do something, somebody's trying to merge or whatever, you know, be a good neighbor and kind of work with people, not always, well, I've got to, you know, inch down the road my way and do things.
Remember the spirit of the season.
Right, the spirit of the season. The other thing is be mindful, too, of all the construction workers, your law enforcement, fire department, EMS and stuff. If there is an accident, these people are focused and trying to accomplish a goal. They don't need to have to worry about somebody sideswiping them, running into
exactly.
them. Pay attention to what's going on. Slow down. You know, we do have the move over law now that requires that if there are emergency vehicles or even now construction vehicles, if they have their flashing lights on and they're working, you are required on the highway to move over or slow down. And that's where a lot of people say, well, I couldn't get over. Well, if you can't get over, you're supposed to slow down.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you need to slow down. Make sure that you don't, because all it takes is a construction worker to, you know, he's focused on what he's doing, and he takes one step backwards wrong, and next thing you know, you smack him with your car or the mirror or something and hurt someone, and nobody wants that.
Exactly.
So be mindful of the people out here working, trying to do things to keep us all safe, make the highways better for us. You have the utility workers, you know, they're trying to restore power or update lines and stuff. All these type things are going on. The other thing I would like to remind people, too, is, like I say, what I've started noticing now in intersections is bad, that people, when traffic's backed up and they run up on a stoplight or an intersection, you know, they tend to want to go on, get in the intersection and kind of wait. And
right.
Next thing you know, the light turns. Well, they can't move because the intersection traffic was backed up on the other side, and now they're sitting in the middle of the intersection. Well, now the other traffic can't move.
Right.
We had a situation not long ago. One of the firemen was telling me that they come through an intersection and it was a busy time, and they had to basically stop and wait for the somebody to get out of the way because, like I say, they're running emergency traffic. So be mindful of that. The law does state that when you come upon an intersection, you're not supposed to proceed into the intersection unless you can clear the intersection into the other side where you're going. So if you come up and you're trying to turn somewhere and it and the traffic is backed up to where you're going, stay on your, you know, on your the, where you are. Don't proceed into the intersection because, like I say, I know it makes you it's only a couple of minutes you're talking about, a cycle of a light or something. So be mindful of that. Take the time. Don't be in such a rush. And that's what I want people to remember now is that let's not be so rushed that we forget about what we're trying to accomplish, get somewhere safely, and just, you know, think about other people. And, you know, if your house was on fire, would you want a fire truck to not be able to get there because somebody's sitting in the intersection blocking it?
Or, you know, if your mother
needs an ambulance or something. So be mindful of that thing that, you know, that's why these rules of the road are there. And we ought to all follow the rules of the road so that we can all be safe.
All right. With that, that's going to bring us to our midpoint break here in the show. We'll be back in just a minute.
Video production funding provided by the Rockingham County Business and Technology Center. Entrepreneur-focused, technology-enabled, future-driven. Visit our website for additional information, rockinghambusiness.org. WLOE Eden.
WMYN Mandan. Listen online all the time. RockinghamCountyRadio.com.
All right, and welcome back to Community Accents. Today is Friday, November the 15th. You're right here listening to WLOE-WMYN Rockingham County Radio with the Sheriff's Office today. Before the break, we were talking about the upcoming holiday season and being safe. A couple more things we want to throw out there. You know, as far as personal safety and falling victim to crime, remember that thefts really do pick up this time of year. Don't leave boxes and stuff out on the curb. Like Captain King said, don't leave packages out in your car that you've just bought. Secure them in your trunk if you're going to eat a bite or something like that. Take them out of your car when you get home. One thing that we've seen here in Rockingham County and all over the place really is what are we sending back and forth this time of year? Of course, cards, gift cards in them and money and stuff like that. The bad guys know this, and they are going through mailboxes looking for mail shaped like cards. Usually we caught several last year that were going through mailboxes and stealing cards, looking for gift cards and stuff like that. My advice to you when it comes to that is if you're going to mail a gift card or card with money in it or anything like that, take it and drop it off by the post office. That takes half of the temptation away right there of leaving it unattended there in the mailbox. And you and your neighbors, speak with your neighbors, and you do the same as well. Keep an eye on each other's mailboxes.
That's going to be the key.
Exactly. And you know, make sure that if you see something, you say something, you know, because people will be out there messing around looking into mailboxes this year. So it's important to notify somebody. Call that magic number 911 if you see anybody out around mailboxes or doing anything suspicious there. Also, if you're like me, you do a lot of shopping online when it comes to the holidays. Love that. Don't have to fight the crowds or anything. Most of them do free shipping and whatnot when it comes to the holiday season. But one thing I want you to be mindful of is when you order that, UPS or FedEx or whoever delivers it, when they drop it off, in the past we've had problems with criminals coming right behind the trucks there, and they pick the package up when there's no other cars there, and they'll take off. So if you're expecting another package, just like we were talking about earlier, nowadays, usually, if you go on a website or call the company that's delivering it, they can tell you almost up to the minute as to when they estimate the time that they're going to deliver that package and what day, and ask a neighbor to go over there and pick that package up before you take it in, and you'll get it when you get home if you're not going to be there.
Well, I've noticed, too, that your UPS and FedEx, I believe both now are stressing that if you've ordered something and you're not sure you're going to be available, you can almost schedule with them kind of either an alternate address to take it to,
yes,
or even a time, like you said, that with the tracking now, that they can tell you, well, it'll be between, you know, this 15-minute window almost now, and you can have
somebody
there.
They've got it down to
there.
A science, especially
that's
this
right.
time of year.
So those are things that you might want to think about, too, because, like I say, we don't want to have people unnecessarily targeted.
Right. You know, crimes of opportunity, like we talked about a little bit earlier, you know, take that opportunity away from the criminals and don't fall victim to a crime. Moving right along with the holiday season and stuff that's coming up, I know we have kicked off our toy and food drives that we do annually there at the Sheriff's Office. We are partnered up with the Eden YMCA and the Rockingham County Red Cross to collect toys and food for needy families right here in Rockingham County. I want to stress that. All of these things that we collect will go to needy Rockingham County families this holiday season.
That's correct. Like I said, the empty stocking drive is something that we partner with the Y there in Eden. I think Major Bullens is a big proponent of that and kind of oversees this and likes to see this very successful. We have always tried to help where we could with our community and give back to our community. So, you know, the officers and the staff can bring stuff, but the public can too. If they have something or a toy or something they want to drop it off, they can bring it by the Sheriff's Office. We have a box out there they can drop a toy in to put in there. And also the food drive, same thing that the Red Cross has told us that there is a big need this year. They're running out of food constantly to do all the food closet stuff. And there are, like I said, there are a lot of people that are struggling this year and have in the past years too. And, you know, hopefully the economy will turn around and things will get better. But until they do, you know, go back like I was talking about earlier, you know, give back to your community, help your neighbor out. And that's what we try to do with these type things is, like I say, with the Red Cross and the toy drive, the less fortunate people, you know, we want to give back and help them have a good holiday season.
Absolutely. Everybody deserves to have a good holiday. You know, I think we take for granted a lot, you know, having food on the table and gifts under the tree. And there are some Rockingham County families that need help with that this season. We'd ask that you'd help. And you don't have to donate a, you know, $50 toy or a, you know, whole turkey or anything like that. Every little bit helps. You know, a can of corn, green beans, whatever. Every little bit helps.
That is correct.
You know, and whatever little toys you want to get, it gives the kid something to open up on Christmas Eve, and Christmas morning rather. You know, it's a big deal all the way around. We are a collection point for these two organizations at the Sheriff's Office. We are open 24/7. If you want to drop off your donations there at the Sheriff's Office, please feel free. We're located right behind the new courthouse there. Just go inside. You'll see two big boxes there. One's marked toys, one marked food. We encourage you please to come out and donate that. If you can't get out, feel free to flag down one of the deputies that's patrolling your area. Give your donation to them, and they'll be glad to bring it to the office for you. And we thank you all in advance for your donations. Also, we've got a lot of other events coming up, too. We've got a late
parade season.
Yes, it's parade season.
Yep.
Cam, why don't you tell us about the upcoming parades? I know we're going to kick it off here pretty quick. I think next Saturday is when it starts.
From my understanding, Riesel is going to be the first parade this year. They've kind of wanted to get the jump, I guess, on everybody else. So they're going to do it on November the 23rd. And this time it's going to be an afternoon, not a nighttime parade. So it's going to be at 4 o'clock in Reedsville. My understanding, the route's going to be pretty much the same as it's always been, just change the time a little bit.
Right.
Then after that, you have on Friday, November the 29th, at 6:30, the Leakesville Parade, and I think that's been a long-standing tradition. They always do it the Friday after Thanksgiving and that will be a nighttime parade. And nighttime parades are pretty because the lights seem to stand out more and stuff. So, like I said, that will be a nighttime parade in Leakesville. Then on Saturday, November the 30th, Stoneville Parade. I'm not sure of the route there in Stoneville yet, but I understand it is a route round through Stoneville, and that's going to be at 3 p.m. there in Stoneville. Then on December the 7th, Draper has their parade, and it's pretty much the same route it's always been. They line up on one side of Draper and drive around, and it's always a big crowd down there in Draper for that parade, and it's at 11 a.m. On the 7th. And then Saturday, December the 14th, you have the Wentworth Parade. It's a good parade. It's there through the Wentworth area down through there. And then at 1 p.m. on that same Saturday, Madison Med Inn has their parade. They start in Med Inn and drive all the way up through Madison. And That's at 1 p.m. on that Saturday, December the 14th. And that's the parades of the county that most everybody, I think, makes one of them anyway.
Exactly.
I seem to see a big crowd at all of them, so everybody does enjoy the parades and stuff.
And it is a lot of fun, both for the participants and those that come to watch. I know we always have a lot of fun in the parade. You can come out and see the sheriff's office in all of the parades this year.
Yep. We'll have a variety of different things in all the different parades.
Mm-hmm. And so I'd encourage you to go out and at least check out your local Christmas parade, if not all of them. It's a great time for the whole family.
Yep.
Now, with that, I want to lead into some news that has occurred here over the past couple of weeks. We have arrested two individuals, Justin James, 20 years old, and Tashawn Richardson, 20 years old, both of Martinsville, Virginia. They were both arrested here recently, stemming from an October 26th home invasion on Anglin Mill Road. What happened was the homeowners were at home in bed asleep around 3:20 in the morning. Their dog, a little dog named Pepsi, woke them up barking there. And once they woke up, they thought they heard somebody downstairs. The gentleman armed himself with his shotgun, went downstairs, and he saw one individual there armed with a hammer standing in his den area of his home inside, and shot at the gentleman. At that point in time, didn't know if he hit him or not. This gentleman then fled the area, was yelling, "Let's go get in the car," something to that effect. So we suspected there was another individual at least involved or there at the scene. Within an hour of that, though, an individual showed up at the Martinsville Hospital with a gunshot wound consistent with the type of shotgun that the homeowner had. But then, to add a little bit more drama to it, within about 30 minutes later, another individual showed up at the Danville Hospital with the same kind of wounds. And so, upon further investigation, we found out that both these gentlemen were involved. I believe a family member or an acquaintance took one to one hospital and one to the other, maybe to, you know, make it seem not as suspicious, showing up in the middle of the night with some gunshot wounds. But these two individuals were tied together, and we believe they were responsible for that home invasion. I know Sheriff Page has spoken at length in the past about the homeowner being the first line of defense there in the home, and he's talked about the Castle Doctrine. Captain, why don't we wrap things up with you telling us a little bit more about the Castle Doctrine and reminding everybody about that and what your rights are as a homeowner to defend yourself and your family.
Well, you know, here again, unfortunately, law enforcement can't be everywhere at every time when you need them.
Right.
It never fails. It seems like when you need a law enforcement officer, it's hours before they get there when it could
be
minutes.
Like,
but here again, it's, you know, we can't be everywhere at every time. You know, there's always something going on. So honestly and truly, you know, most people need to realize that, like I say, you are the one that's going to be ultimately responsible for your own safety to some extent. You know, naturally we want you to call 911, get us en route. But in the Castle Doctrine, that's what the legislature finally decided that, well, you know, people, you know, need to be able to protect themselves. And then they've kind of spelled that out in the Castle Doctrine law that says, you know, if you're in your home, your automobile, or your workplace, and, you know, you feel your life is in danger and someone is threatening you or making moves or coming at you in a way that would make you or a reasonable person think that their life is in danger, you have the right to protect yourself. And, you know, you use the means that whatever means needs to be to protect yourself. And that's what the Castle Doctrine does. It gives you the right to protect yourself and your family if somebody tries to hurt you. And that's what we have to do, because, like I say, I would not want anybody to hurt me or my family, and I would do whatever I needed to do to try to stop somebody from doing that. And that's what the Castle Doctrine basically just spells that out in the law that says that you can't be sued or found criminally liable if you do protect yourself and you follow the law.
And that's the important part, the change in the law there, because the burden was on the homeowner prior to right. the change in the law to right. prove that you felt you were in danger.
Right.
Now it's assumed that if the bad guy's in your house, yeah. car, workplace, and he's not supposed to be, then it's automatically assumed that he's there to try to hurt somebody. He or she's there to try to hurt somebody. And so that covers the homeowner. I think it's also important to notate that no charges are expected to be drawn against the homeowner at this point in time. The investigation,
everything was turned over to the district attorney.
Yeah, everything's turned over.
They make the call, but that's what we understand.
Yeah, we're not anticipating anything at this point in time. Earlier in the summer, I know we had another incident where a gentleman
had to make a call on that one, too, and he determined no charges would be filed.
Right, covered under the castle.
That's right.
All right. Well, with that, that's going to bring us to the end of the show this morning. We thank you for being here, as always, and we'll see you next month right here on Community Accents, WLOE, WMYN.